Something that you might have already encountered in the past, challenges in teaching, learning English as a second language. I was somewhat adamant in putting just English as a second language because it's possible also that some of us may be coming from an EFL background, but in order for it to be of equal footing for everybody in the audience, I have just used ESL, but please bear in mind that this may also be applicable to EFL learners and teachers. So this is simply just a general overview. Okay. Let me see. Is this the... Okay. So first, let us have the general questions. The very first thing that we need to ask ourselves is, how do we perceive English as a second language in terms of its challenging task in our respective country? Before I ask you, or if you would like to share something, let me share with you the perceived challenges in teaching ESL in my own country. First of all, a few years back, English is something that my first idea is that English is not going to be very difficult for many Filipinos. So if ever I am going to get myself into this field, I'm not going to have a difficult time because I don't know if you are aware, but in the Philippines, English is widely spoken more than actually the native language. Especially when you go to the city center, which is Manila, many of the people would already be speaking in English, and English is highly influential. We are so exposed to English that I don't think it's going to be a difficult field to get into. However, that was I think about a decade ago. Now it's becoming, and from experience teaching Filipino students, it is becoming a little difficult now to communicate in the English language, and there are a lot of reasons to be attributed to that. However, I'm not going to talk about the problems that we are encountering right now as much as I would want to in my country, because you may also have your own struggles in terms of learning or teaching English. So, if I may, can you cite a particular challenge that you are experiencing as a learner of English in your country? Are you experiencing any challenges as well?
Okay. Ada yang mau comment? Is there any comment for the students? Is that challenging as a learner, English learner?
Yes, I think it would be nice if we hear the side of the students in terms of the challenges that they are facing right now.
Okay. Ada yang kom? Okay, silakan.
Me, Faisal.
Yes. Okay.
I think the most challenging is the application. I mean, the speaking part of the English. If we talk about the listening part, we can just listen to maybe movie or listen to the song. As for the read, we can read a lot of English part, but the speaking part is difficult because we can use it in someone who doesn't understand English. And we, as for the foreigner, it's a bit difficult too because we usually don't see them a lot in here.
Yes.
I think that is the part, the challenge.
I totally agree with you, Faisal. You know what? Many of the things that you have mentioned will be touched on by this presentation. This is indeed one of the biggest challenges, and that is the speaking portion. And I understand that the speaking per se inside of the classroom is something that is touched on. However, there may be very limited opportunity for you to practice speaking outside of the classroom. So that is a very good answer, Faisal, and something which, again, I would like to emphasize a little bit universal in many of the countries which use English as a foreign language, also as a second language. I used to believe believe that English is a second language in the Philippines. Sometimes it even is considered to be a primary language. But now I am encountering a lot of students who are already struggling in terms of speaking in English. They can understand English quite well, especially when they are reading. And I understand that might also be the same case in Indonesia. They can write in English, but the difficulty comes from expressing themselves orally. So let us take a look at how is the educational system is in the Philippines addressing this primary challenge. It is a little bit funny, guys, that the Philippines, when I was still taking up my primary schooling, has always been English in terms of medium of instruction. I remember when I was still in elementary, I don't remember my teachers ever speaking in Tagalog. Tagalog is one of the major languages in the Philippines, and in Manila, that is the native language. When you go to the province, when you go to Visayas, or when you go to another major island, it's a totally different native language. But from where I come from, it is Tagalog. So I don't remember them ever speaking to me in Tagalog. It has always been English. Many of the resources that we are provided with inside of the classroom are all English-based. So I understand that English has become a part of our lives and something that we do not struggle with when we are going to communicate with other people, may it be a native speaker of English or may it be from another Asian country. It is quite opposite, however, in other countries. Like in Japan and in South Korea, it has always been their native language all throughout. And English is something that they are introduced to when they probably reach their high school stage or the high school level. And that is what I've heard from my students, because I think you are aware also that in the Philippines, there are many Koreans and there are many Japanese who would go to the Philippines in order to learn English and in a somewhat inexpensive way, because it's going to be very expensive if they would always try to study in the US or in Canada. So the Philippines is a very good option to learn English and it's not going to hurt your pocket at all. So, however, come 2012, that's just about a decade from now, a decade ago, so come 2012, they have introduced the K-12 in the Philippines. I do not want to talk about this in length, but to just give you an idea, the Philippines, together with another country, is the only country with a 10-year educational system before 2012. So in 2012, they have proposed that it's going to be a 12-year educational system, just like how it is in Indonesia, just like how it is in Japan, and in many, many countries all over the world. I think, like what I said, there are just two countries prior to 2012, which would have a 10-year educational system. And according to our government, that has to change. Because we are being left behind when it comes to mathematics and sciences. So they feel that an added 2 years in high school would elevate the level of the Filipinos when it comes to sciences. Together with the introduction of the K-12, they have changed the language policy. English now is going to be introduced after grade three. So that's what you have there. After grade three is the only time they will be exposed to English. So it became the opposite with many of the countries that I have mentioned a while ago, such as Japan and South Korea, because from introducing English in these countries come high school, they have now started introducing English come primary. So it became the opposite. The Philippines now feels that they do not have to be exposed to English immediately, okay, in order to elevate the knowledge in the sciences. And English is just something which can be introduced once they are finished with the primary schooling. That is the language policy now that we have in place in the Philippines. Do you have a language policy in Indonesia in order to fulfill the practical need of the learners in learning English?
I don't think there is a written policy about language okay. in Indonesia so far, mm-hmm. as far as I know. But mm-hmm. many playgroup or kindergarten nowadays, mm-hmm. They use yes. English as a basic language.
Already?
Yes. I mean, okay. they try to, how do you call it, to teach the youngest, mm-hmm. youngsters to learn English, to communicate mm-hmm. in English every day. Mm-hmm. I know because I have been a part of kindergarten school before I become a lecturer. They use English as a basic every day mm-hmm. when they communicate with their teacher and when they ask for something or when mm-hmm. they need something, they ask in English. They have
English.
To. Yes, they have to. So it's part of their daily life.
Okay. And that is probably a language policy. That is probably mm-hmm. something allowed by the government. Okay.
Yeah.
Because in our case, we have been given the freedom in Manila, which like what they said, the capital of my country, mm-hmm. we have been given the privilege to use English immediately upon the kids getting into schooling, which is in kindergarten. But in other parts of the Philippines, they are a little strict in making sure that the native language is used. So that is what the government imposes, that you really have to make sure that the native language is used in teaching these kids up until grade 3, okay, in order to elevate the status of the entire country when it comes to ranking for the sciences. So this is not really to say that we are putting languages in the shadows, but this is because the government feels that since English is a second language and since English is pretty much everywhere, okay, when you go out of your house, you see signboards in English, you don't see signboards in Tagalog or in any Philippine language. Everybody speaks in English. Even our politicians speak in English. English is revered as a glory, as a language that is supposed to be mastered in order to be good in business and trade. So English has that status in my country. So they're not going to have a hard time. However, going back to what I have mentioned a while ago, English was not a difficult thing for the Filipinos before a few years back. Suddenly, I am faced with students who struggle when it comes to speaking to me. And that is something I have not experienced before. Okay, so probably there is something that has to be changed. I am not saying that this change should immediately be in a national level. It can be something as localized as your classroom. Okay, so for those who are trying to get into the field of teaching English, I hope that the things I will be talking about here will help you identify or zoom in into the problems that you are encountering in the classroom and be able to come up with decisions which are individualized, okay? Because sometimes the general law or the general policy may not immediately apply to everybody in our classes. Okay, so I understand that there are times when a language policy is not immediately imposed nationally, locally, in the community, but it is important for you as a language, as a budding language teacher or as a language teacher to have a language policy of your own. So a language policy will be able to address these three items. First, it will be able to help your students communicate in English in the real context. You know, communicating in English academically is not considered to be a full success if that person will not be able to communicate once placed in an actual context where they have to survive, you know? So at gunpoint, will you be able to speak in English and will you be able to communicate to another person? That is the important thing here. And that's also the reason why I always tell my students that grammar is not important. Like Faisal, you have given your viewpoint a while ago about the challenges you think you are facing as a learner of English, but I totally understood what you are trying to say. So I don't think there is a problem with that. The moment you can communicate your thoughts, the moment you can give what you mean, then the communication has been successful. Okay. And also we have to make sure that the language policy that we are following, again, or the language policy that we have personally inside of our classes, should be able to satisfy the different communicative needs. Now, communicative needs have totally evolved into something so modern that sometimes I do not even understand if the communicative needs I was made to believe a long time ago still apply. What are these communicative needs, therefore, in using and learning English? At the end of my presentation, I am going to present to you the newer ones, okay? Because I am pretty sure at this point, you know what a communicative need is, but these are not anymore the communicative needs that we have to satisfy, especially at this point where we are in a pandemic, okay? At least in the Philippines, we're still in a general lockdown and everything is online. So your communicative need to speak the language, the target language, may be slightly different from the communicative needs that I will be presenting in a while. Okay, so now I will be going to the meat of the presentation, and that would be to present to you the current and the persisting challenges faced by not only the students, but also the teachers and the schools in terms of learning and teaching English. The very first one is, I believe, the problem of a lot of people, and not only of those trying to get into English, but also of those who are struggling to know English. Why do I keep, I do not want to say any other language that you are trying to learn may apply. However, English is the one that is considered to be spoken by about 300 million people all over the world. And in order to communicate to this 300 million people, English has to be learned. There is not enough environment to be familiar with the language is a primary problem. When you step out of your classroom, okay, let's make it really specific. When you step out of the classroom, do you have the opportunity to still speak in English? Do you have the opportunity to still communicate with someone who speaks in English? Are you provided with an ample environment in order to practice this? I know for a fact that in the Philippines, there are a lot of schools, okay, which have implemented an English-only zone. So meaning everybody employed in that classroom, may it be the security guards, may it be the cleaners, everybody should be speaking in English. So this is trying to provide an environment that is conducive with the target language. So that is one current and persisting challenge. In an EFL context, I don't think the environment is as conducive in learning English. So you are already aware of this one. What therefore are you going to do, okay, personally, in order for this to materialize for your own students or for it to materialize to you personally as a learner of English? Okay. Next is, there is no active role for English outside of the classroom. There is just no reason for you to speak in English. And according to, I'm sorry if I keep on calling on Faisar, because Faisar was the only one who was able to, I was only able to listen to the challenges brought up by Faisar. But I do believe that this is something shared by a lot of people in the audience.
Yeah, that's true.
And Miss Andy,
Yeah, that's true. As their lecturers also, mm-hmm. that I believe they just only try to speak in English in class, but after class,
no more.
No, no one try.
Okay. You know what? When I have attended that conference, when I gave that lecture in Makassar, Indonesia, I did not see a lot of foreigners as well. Mm-hmm. I did not see a lot of, people from the US or people who would only speak in English.
Westerners.
Westerners, okay, yeah. that might be a problem also. But again, that is something that is outside of our control, I believe. Something that we do not have any control over. But see, there is no reason for you to speak in English because there no one is demanding it, okay, outside of the classroom. I think the only demand that we have right now for English is when we are interested in watching something on Netflix and it is in English. That is the only active role it has assumed now that we are in a pandemic, right? Mm. And the problem sometimes is when your favorite show, which happens to be in English, would have subtitles in your own language, then it becomes a problem because you are not giving an enough opportunity to be more active in your life in order for you to learn it well. Please do not discredit watching movies with subtitles. I also know for a fact that it is possible for you to learn another language through this medium. I have encountered several of my students who were able to learn Japanese. And Japanese is not well spoken. And Japanese is also one language which is like English probably in Makassar, Indonesia. We do not have a lot of Japanese in the Philippines. We have a lot of Koreans on the other hand. But they were able to learn...
They are able to learn Korean through Korean drama, K-pop.
That's right. And that is so true. I think also we share the same fascination for Korean dramas.
I have many. I have an experience that when I watch Korean drama, I choose English subtitle. And one of my colleagues asked me, why did you watch Korean drama with English subtitle? And I told him that I couldn't watch Korean drama with Indonesian because I need to learn their Korean language.
That's true. That's true.
English subtitle. That's funny.
That's true. And I haven't really watched a lot of Korean dramas. Mm-hmm. I think I was only able to just watch one or two. But I also know that Filipinos are very fascinated with Koreans.
That's true.
But I don't think I have ever learned the sound of Korean, even if we have a lot of them in the Philippines, despite me watching the Korean dramas. However, like what I said, there are some students of mine who were able to learn Japanese just by watching Japanese anime and having the subtitles. So it is a possible avenue for you to learn the target language also, but it is not something that is recommended. Of course, you still being able to talk in the target language would require other things. This is the most passive of it all, but it can happen. Okay, so whatever it is that you do, which exposes you to the target language, that would be helpful. Okay, nothing is irrelevant at this point. And then you have limited contact and negotiation of meaning. I think this one is, although the challenges that I am posting here are not linear, they are all connected to each other. So, of course, if you feel that there is no active role for English, there will be very limited contact. And if you have limited contact, you will not be able to negotiate for meaning. Negotiation for meaning or negotiation of meaning is something which can actually happen inside of the classroom. And in fact, it is an opportunity that you should present to your students or you should present to yourselves if you would really like to learn English and if you would really like to make your students learn. Negotiation of meaning means that English should be taught even if it is not your first language or even if you are not comfortable with the language, but if you are the professor, if you are the teacher of that target language, you should make sure that you use it even if you are not teaching. Again, let me cite an example coming from my EFL students enrolled in our university. They would all tell me that in their English classes, their Korean teachers would never talk to them in English. When there is a question that they need to raise, the Korean teacher would speak in Korean. It is not to explain the concept in the target language. So of course, it's going to be very easy if you are going to do it that way, if you're going to shift to your native language and trying to explain the concept because you will be able to explain it better. but you are not providing them an opportunity to negotiate with the meaning. So even if you are struggling, your student is struggling, but if you are still trying your very best to speak in English, you are negotiating with that meaning until you arrive at an understanding. So that, according to a lot of studies, is one very good way of making the students learn English and would also help you eventually until you become comfortable in the language. You will never be comfortable in speaking it if you are always adamant in using the English language, if you are always thinking of committing lapses and being embarrassed and being laughed at because you have a lot of lapses, because I understand that it would always start from somewhere. So if you are struggling with English, but you are constant in making sure that you use it in your daily affairs, then it's not going to be far behind that you will be better at it in the long run. Okay, so the next one would be, I believe this is something shared also by a lot of teachers that we have here, Miss Andy and Mr. Yusri. We have limited materials, both authentic and non-authentic. Again, let me try to talk about how it is done in my university. In my university, there is already a very active campaign of using 80% authentic materials inside of our classes, even if we have a standard textbook. So for example, in the English 1 class that I handled several years back, because we do not have English 1 now because of the K-12, again, because many of the general subjects have already been given to high school. So English 1 would have its own textbook, had its own textbook. However, many of the items in that textbook came from authentic materials or came from authentic sources. If we are going to limit the use of authentic materials, then our students would not be exposed to authentic language, and they would only be exposed to something that has been pre-programmed in order to attain the objective of the lesson. And that might be hard if you are going to immediately shift to a context where English should be used in an authentic setting, okay? Because they will always have to refer to the kind of language that is not really used outside. Like usually non-authentic materials would not have impressions, expressions. They would not have... corrections of the devices that you use. There will not be any self-correction in these non-authentic materials. So you are limiting your students if you are only going to use non-authentic materials inside of the classroom. Of course, preparing for our lessons and making sure that we have authentic materials would entail a lot of work and would entail a lot of time. But if at this point you can include one or two authentic materials coming from magazines or coming from journals, that would already be of a big help. So authentic materials may also come in the form of TV news or programs. Again, I remember before how YouTube channels or those teachers would always make their students watch something. They are actually frowned upon. But now I have been informed that there are a lot of YouTube educational channels which we can make our students watch, and that these are considered at times to be authentic materials, and then there should of course be processing afterwards. Sometimes these YouTube educational channels come with a price, sometimes they are free, but it would be very good if we can use a variety of materials and presenting a particular topic to the students and not just all coming from the textbook. Again, I am speaking from the experience that I have as a teacher in my country, because it may not necessarily be something that we can implement in Indonesia. I don't know, okay? But we have a margin of flexibility as a teacher in our own classroom. So in our own classroom, even if we know that there are things we need to accomplish and all of which are coming in a textbook, we know that we can still insert every now and then things which may be outside but which would help them understand the lesson better. And my suggestion is to include as much authentic material as possible. So again, this one is connected to the previous one. If you do not have as much role for English outside of the class, English is only deemed as something which you need to attend as a subject, then you would have very limited strategies in learning English. Context clues, for example, is taught as context clues with the accompanying definitions, but you are not allowing your students to apply context clues as beautiful strategies in reading. So then they would again have limited strategies once they are outside and they are trying to communicate and negotiate in order to arrive at the meaning with whoever it is that they are talking with. So limited strategies also would stem from limited role given to the target language. They will not have a chance to polish these strategies in order for them to learn, not learn English as a subject, but to learn the use of the target language. Okay, there are so many. And this one, if notice, has been given an entire page because I understand how this one may be one of the most important. Self-directed learning happens only when students are provided with an opportunity for critical thinking. Since I was given the choice of Mr. Yusri to talk about how I experience it in my country, I would always go back to how it is in my country. A long time ago, to just give you a background, my university used the transmissive way of learning. So when you say transmissive, everything is coming from the professor, everything is coming from the teacher, and you are expected to provide the materials, you're expected to provide the lectures, you're expected to do a lot of talking, you're expected to direct the activities, to orchestrate the activities, everything is coming from the teacher. To the extent that when the teacher is absent, the entire session would fall apart. Okay, and you are considered to be absent. You have to make that up because you are the one who is orchestrating everything inside of the classroom. And then we have shifted to the transformative way of learning. And when you say transformative, you transform what you think the students already know, and you anchor the learning from there. So transformative now is when students would be doing 80% of the work. 20% will be coming from the teacher. That was accepted with resistance. So many of the teachers who are just so used to the traditional way of teaching felt that there will be no learning that would take place if it's going to be 80% student work, because now the administration would make sure that only 20% teacher talk would happen inside of the classroom. If you keep on talking and talking, 20 minutes to your talk, the students are already in the Bahamas. They are already somewhere else. They would be already thinking of something else because, you know, there are a lot of things which contribute to that. Physiology, it's just not possible. Psychologically, we get tired. We cannot absorb too much information if we are going to be lectured on for an hour. And that is something that has already been proven. Thus, after we got the hang of the transformative way of learning, we have learned that students actually became more autonomous. They became more in charge of their learning. They were given the opportunity to learn outside of the formal scheme of instruction. In a while, I will be showing you a concept which is applicable to autonomous learning. Autonomous learning entails more group works. Autonomous learning means that there should be more collaborative works. There should be more projects. They should be given a chance to talk to each other. They should be given a chance to analyze. Because if we are always going to talk and we are always going to lecture, okay, in Bloom's taxonomy of learning, that would just be hitting two levels, two of the lowest levels, knowledge and comprehension. It is not addressing the third up until the highest level of learning. The third being applicable, analysis, you have evaluation, you have synthesis. These things are not addressed. So we have learned to accept a transformative way of learning as something that is more progressive because it's giving the students a chance to consciously monitor their performances. Writing in my country is not anymore done as an output-based activity. It is now a process-based activity where they are not graded in one shot. So they submit an output. They will not be graded out of that. They will be given a chance to monitor their performance by giving them a chance to revise, by giving them a chance to read other people's work, to rate other people's work, to collect all of this and to monitor their progress. And then they submit a final portfolio at the end. Okay, and it is the portfolio which is going to be graded according to how well they have progressed from start to finish. So, you know what, this all of these strategies that we are applying and all of these strategies that we believe to be transformative reduces as well the anxiety of the students. It removes the frustration, not only of the students, but also of the teacher. Sometimes when we grade our students in one shot, we become frustrated because there are just so many things we have learned, which we do not see in one shot, right? So if you are going to make use of this transformative way of learning, frustration, the feeling of alienation, the anxiety level of the students and of the teachers also, all of these would significantly be less. Okay, so that is, I understand a possible problem given a lot of external factors, but if we are going to try to at least be a little transformative, even if not so much, it can already help to some extent. Okay, for a commercial break, I remember taking up two of my subjects in the PhD program under this professor who was really, really brilliant. And we were all very excited to be enrolled in his class because he graduated from Yale University and he is well-cited, very, very good professor, only to find out that inside of his classes, he would never lecture. He would ask us to always form a circle and to talk about the article ourselves. He would only intervene when there would already be disagreements, but he would never lecture. And with all honesty, I think I have learned more from his subjects compared to the other subjects where we would have reporting after reporting after reporting, okay, which is highly transmissive, I tell you. Okay, moving on. Another problem is the misaligned belief about the nature of learning English. Do we start inductively? Do we start with the word? After the word, do we move on to the sentence and then the paragraph and then the essay? Is that still how we attack the learning of a language? Because that has already been debunked several times. And again, it is understandable if that is still being followed in some EFL setup, but it is, you have to expect that it's not going to be effective. You have to prepare yourself that at the end of the school year, they will probably know the parts of a sentence, they will probably know the parts of a paragraph, but they will still not be able to communicate well. Okay, so the inductive way of learning has been the way of life come during the a century ago in the Philippines. Now we know that that's not the way to learn English. English should be taught simultaneously with the four macro skills. So you cannot separate vocabulary, for example. Like you are going to present to the students 10 words. Okay, these 10 words, you have to know the meaning, and then you write the definition on the board, and then you make them memorize, and then you're going to worse test them according to what they remember. It's a test of memory, not a test of knowledge, or not a test of being able to apply these words in natural context. You know what's the worst part of it? They will never remember the definition ever. And the worst is they will even forget the word right after your class. It has never been deemed effective. So that is a misaligned belief about how to learn not only English, but any language. If you are going to start with the smallest parcel and you move on to the bigger one, when in fact it has to be attacked holistically. Next is, again, this one, it's something that we have no control over, but it has to be mentioned, the heterogeneous language levels in a classroom. I believe that I am handling a class with different language levels. And the problem sometimes is when you are faced with a class with the differing language levels, but there is a curriculum that has to be finished. So whatever happens, you try to implement that curriculum, even if there are some who will not be able to follow, there are some who are just about right with it, and there are some who get bored because they already know what you are talking about. So, you know, differing levels. We do not have time to always conduct needs analysis. There is something that needs to be accomplished. And I understand that. Even if we have a big, room to be flexible in our classes, me being a professor in a university, I still struggle at times with those students who are slightly left behind. Because that means that, you know, I have to lower down the discussion a little bit, okay? And this is stemming from the theory of Stephen Krashen, that learning would only take place with I plus one. So I being the input plus one, meaning it has to be one level higher. But if you are going to always apply the I plus one formula of Stephen Krashen, and you have a heterogeneous language levels in the classroom, you again can expect that there are those who will not be able to learn as much. Okay, I understand that all of the students would learn to some extent, but the kind of learning that we are hoping they would be able to absorb may also be different at the end of the school year. Okay, and then crowded classes, which lead to lack of practice in English due to limited hours of instruction. How many students do you usually have in your classes?
30 is the maximum numbers.
30, that is a very good number.
Yes.
It is. Even now in the online learning, it still is 30?
Yes, because the policy from the university say that per classroom, 30.
Okay.
For all.
You are very lucky because in my university, yes. I'm handling now four classes, and two of these classes would be more than 40. One is, an English, the other, I'm lucky that the other two are very small in number, but that is because I'm handling one major subject in English, so they are about just 9 in the class, and the other one is a graduate school, and I only have 16. Mm-hmm. But for the two classes, I am handling 40 plus students, and that is a writing class. Okay. Oh, yeah, that's right. So, you know, we try to go around this particular, in order to address the crowded number of students, in order to have not limited hours of instruction. Though it is a writing class, it is by group. Okay, so just like in a thesis, right? In a research project, usually you would have co-authors, right? You would have people to work with. So that is also the same impression that we give them. When you make your bigger research project later on, it is usually not individual. It is by group. So you should be able to work with the group. You should be able to collaborate with the group. You should be able to communicate with the group in terms of review of related literature, in terms of making sure that everything that you are to collect will be able to flow smoothly from the start until the finish. So it may be a problem for some, but there would always be a solution. So if you are faced with a problem that you feel you have no control over, you have to find a way in order to make sure that you are not limiting them in terms of hours of instruction. Okay, so that is a possible thing which other schools who are not as privileged would experience, crowded classrooms. So I think I have already mentioned to you the first one, lack of group work or activities. Why is it that group activities are not exhausted as much as they should, when in fact group activities and group work should make up about 90% of the time per session? I guess it has something to do with coordination. Sometimes it's a little bit hard to coordinate the students. Sometimes it is a little bit difficult to address problems, such as there are freeloaders in a group, there are some group members who are not contributing, there are some students who are not very comfortable working with a group. Okay, but you have to understand that this would still be better off significantly compared to an individual activity, because again, group activities and group work would allow the students to exhaust the language if you are consciously monitoring how they would be communicating with each other. I remember how we were instructed that even in group activities, you have to make sure that students are talking in the target language. So they have to make sure that they would try to talk to each other in English, and you call on their attention. It's okay for you to call on their attention if they are shifting to the native language. There may be the problem of code switching, okay? Though it's frowned upon and though it's something that we do not allow as much, it still is better off, I believe, than speaking purely in the native language. So you have to always encourage them. Please communicate in the target language. Please communicate in the target language as they are talking to each other. Of course, after the group work or activity, there will be a presentation, or there will be some sort of a communication that they need to do. That, of course, has to be in English, definitely. But during downtime, when they are trying to work on a project or trying to work on a problem, it still has to be in the target language. Another problem is the lack of motivation or purpose for learning English. I believe this one is more extrinsic than extrinsic. When you are lacking motivation, there is just no reason for you to learn it. If you think that I am going to be a physics teacher, I'm going to be a math teacher, I'm going to get into engineering, I am going to be a doctor, so what is the reason for me to thoroughly be good in the target language? They do not have the motivation to learn because they do not have any friends who speak just English. They do not travel outside of their country. They do not have plans of working outside of the country. They do not have plans of migrating. A lot of things, a lot of reasons why they can convince themselves that I don't have to learn English.
Why should I?
Yeah. That's right. How about you, Miss Andy? Have you experienced like going in countries where it's really just English that is being spoken by most of the citizens, and you know that you really have to up your game and be able to communicate in English?
Yeah, the first time I traveled when I was in college, fourth semester or third, I forgot. Mm-hmm. It's Singapore, actually, my first time. Yeah, they speak English. The yes, Chinese, Indian, they have their own accents.
That's right. Thank you.
Uh-huh. At the first, I have to listen carefully what they say, mm-hmm. because some of them speaking very fast, mm-hmm. sometimes with the accent, so I couldn't catch the word.
And in Singapore, it's multi. It's so many.
Yes, that's
It's multicultural.
Multicultural, multi-ethnic, yeah, and they have
right.
many jargon accents. That's a challenge for me.
Yeah, they have a lot of different ways of speaking in English.
In the Malaysia right. also, some of mm-hmm. them, mm-hmm. And some other time I traveled to the Europe when they use English. Uh-huh. That's better for me, I think. Even though they speak very fast, but the accent is not very hard to understand.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because maybe I'm used to it rather than used to the East Asian English.
Mm, that's correct.
I've been to Manila also, and mm-hmm. I like the way they talk. It's similar to us Indonesian, I think. Even though I agree what you said that. English is very popular in Manila, in Filipina. Mm-hmm. But I believe if I try to speak with them nicely, slowly, mm-hmm. we can communicate well.
Yeah, that's right. So accent is a primary consideration. It's a problem when we communicate. And however, even if we're having a hard time understanding because of their accent, we also have to... we have to disregard whether our accent is similar or different, because if we are going to be so consumed with the way we sound, it's going to hinder the way that we communicate.
That's
so
true.
It's very difficult if you believe that, that's going to be a very rare occasion in my life. If I am going to go, me going out of the country and communicating in English, and that can lead to the lack of motivation or purpose in learning English. You are very lucky, like Miss Andy and Mr. Yusri, that you are provided an opportunity every day to use English. But I am pretty sure there are many Indonesians who are not in the field of teaching English or who are not in the field of languages, which do not have any opportunity at all to practice it, and they are just fine with that. Okay, but of course this is a problem that we need to address, especially if we are becoming more global right now.
That's true.
I remember before how I need to travel in order to provide all of these lectures in conferences whenever I am invited. Now, see, I was invited virtually, okay, which makes it very easy for me to travel, albeit virtually, and be exposed to people of a different race. And of course, the only language that we can communicate in is English. What else do we have here? Misaligned practices of simply preparing students for the examination and not to make them skilled in the use of the language they are learning. Okay. Again, I am treading on dangerous grounds when I say that we have to make sure that students primarily should be able to learn English and screw examinations, because sometimes we are evaluated according to the success of the students. So we are torn. We would like our students to learn English, but we are also torn in making sure that we cover the curriculum, okay? But just like what I have advised a while ago, for the students, okay? This is for the students and not for the teachers. Even if you are fully aware that there is something that you need to cover in the curriculum, and that might be limiting your teachers in making you practice English, personally, if you want to learn it because you're going to be teachers someday or because you would really like to be good in the language, you have to provide opportunities for yourselves to practice it. It's not always in the classroom where you learn it, okay? I don't remember learning English when I was studying. I have learned English even before I have started getting into my education, I have learned, I can still remember being able to read in English, okay, books, children's books in English, even before I was in school. So I could not entirely say that I have learned English because of school. Probably the kind of English that I know now has been polished because I have attended school all the way until PhD. But many of the things that I know right now in terms of being able to communicate to a native speaker stemmed from me practicing it outside of the class. Being surrounded by people who speak in English, watching English movies and English TV shows, listening to English songs, pretty much exposing myself to the language. Okay, so you also have to have an active role, even if many of the things that I am presenting here seem to be targeting how it should be done inside of a classroom. Another thing which I would like to point out to the students is, sometimes you have high expectations of English. You expect the teachers to cover all examinable topics. And that is a lot of times the fault of the student. When you feel that this should have been taught to us, the reason why I don't know this is because the teacher did not cover this one. The reason why I don't know this one is because the teacher did not include it in many of the sessions, even if I feel this to be a part of the syllabus or of the curriculum. So you have that kind of expectation when in fact learning a language should be subconsciously done. So something that you do inside of the classroom, of course, is conscious, but if you're not going to give yourself a fighting chance, it would never happen. And that also means that you have to get some of these expectations away from the teacher or of the classroom and to yourself. So in order for it to happen, you also have to make sure that you are assuming an active role. And last but not the least is macro skills are taught in isolation. So what was raised a while ago is that you feel that you can read in English, feel that, yeah, when I listen to someone speak in English, I could understand, but I do not get to speak in English in a way that I really want to. You can probably look at how you are attacking the language. Are you trying to learn it by memorizing words and their meanings? Are you trying to attack it by giving the responsibility solely to your teachers? Are you not exposing yourself to the language as much as you should? So this also means that are you talking to your peers in the target language? Okay, so you're probably not practicing it as much. It is a skill class. To the members of the audience who are still studying English, it is a skill. It is not a strategy. And a skill is something that you need to practice in order to be good at. A strategy, on the other hand, is something that is readily available and something that you can take when you want something easily done. For example, when you read in English and you encounter a word that you do not know, do you look at a dictionary or you continue reading and eventually be able to understand what that word means with the use of the surrounding words, probably the sentences afterwards or with the entire paragraph, you get to identify, okay, so this is the meaning of the word. So doing it that way means that you have applied the strategy of context clues. Am I correct? It is a choice that you have taken for yourself. But if you would like to consult a dictionary because, no, I want to be precise, I want to know the meaning of a word, you have consciously chosen not to use a strategy. But being good in English is not just a strategy, it's a skill. So if it isn't practiced, if it is not used, you will never be able to learn it. Okay? So I think this one has already been answered. What is the most neglected macro skill in your country? I suppose it is speaking. Okay? As at the start mentioned by one of the students, and I believe also seconded by Miss Andy, speaking is something which is a neglected macro skill. It has to go hand in hand with the other macro skills. And whatever, I am not here to tell you the different things that you can do, the activities that you can perform in your classes in order for this to happen, but you already know that it should never be, one macro skill should never, ever be taught in isolation. Now, if you recall, a while ago, I said that I'm going to present to you the modern communicative needs. There are so many communicative needs that we have been made aware of, but the more modern ones seem to be more complex or more complicated. I only have here three. Sadly, a modern communicative need now is being able to access and use latest technological and scientific resources, mainly written in English, to be read with an acceptable level of efficiency and proficiency. What do we mean by this? In order for us not to be consumed with fake news, okay, I think fake news, that is a topic that is also widely debated because the onset of the internet, we have to make sure that we are well-read. And usually, research-based materials are written in the kind of English that is already considered sophisticated. When we are presented with such articles, scholarly journals, do we get to understand these scholarly journals in an acceptable level of efficiency and proficiency? That is now a communicative need that is more modern and something that you have to ask yourself. Is it something that I can do already? Okay. Next one is, can I cope with the demands of the era of information, okay, found on the net? Information explosion and the efficient use of the internet. You have so many articles. Are you exposed to articles in your native language? Good thing for my country, there are most of the things given by the government, okay, like the memorandums and all that, they are all in English. Many of the articles that we are exposed in are all in English. But do we have the discernment to know which one is correct and which one is not? So being able to understand is not enough. You should be able to efficiently use it, so which means being able to discern if it is fake news, if it is research-based, if it is opinionated, if it is a hanging article, which means that no one is going to take responsibility if the information there is correct or not. And then the third one is, can you master the language now, which facilitates cultural exchange among nations, including the proposal of the dialogue among civilizations? So going back to what was discussed a while ago, there is a very limited mobility right now, and we find it also difficult to go out of the country and expose ourselves to people who speak in English. And so there is very few rooms or very little opportunity for us for negotiation. But you have to understand that being able to learn English or being able to learn that I do not want to keep on using the word English, but sadly, it really is the language of the business and trade. And so if you are not going to master that language, which is being spoken by more than half of the globe, you are not giving yourself an opportunity to have a dialogue among civilizations. I think you are aware that Indonesia, together with the Philippines, we are a part of the ASEAN integration, and there are many policies that we share right now. In fact, one of the policies is that if I will be going to Indonesia and I will be taking some subjects in Indonesia, it has to be something which will be acknowledged by my country. So that is a part of the ASEAN integration. But even so, even with the ASEAN integration, English is still the primary language to be used. So if you are not trying and giving yourself the chance to learn this, then it might be very difficult for you to be a part of the integration of the nations, which would only be, sadly, using the English language. So thank you very much for listening to what I have prepared for you today, and I hope that I was able to meet the objective of USRI of presenting the challenges of the English language, both in my country and in Indonesia, and hopefully this is also something which would transcend other Southeast Asian countries.
Okay, thank you to Ms. Cristina. It's really useful for us. It's really wonderful topics to be discussed today. Basically, there are some questions from the participants. The first participant who want to give a question is like Jay Mark from Thailand. Jay Mark, time is yours.
Jay Mark, okay. Hey, Jay Mark was a co-author in one of the articles that we are trying to publish. What's your question? Mark, time is
yours.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah. I would just like to ask a question, like, does economic background, like, does it factor in the motivation factor of the student?
The economic background. Are you asking from experience in your own institution, Mr. J. Mark? Okay. I do not want to dwell so much on the economic and the political side of learning English, but yes, I understand that it might impact a little bit the motivation of the students. Just like what I have discussed a while ago, if economically you are not economically stable in order for you to be able to travel more, so there seem to be very little opportunity for you to practice the target language, and therefore you're not going to be as motivated to learn it, because you know that there will not be any opportunity anyway, or if ever you will be presented with the opportunity, it's going to be a privilege and something that is not a right. So yes, that can affect the level of motivation in trying to learn the language.
Thank you so much, Prof.
Okay, thank you, Mr. J. Mark, for a question. Okay, is there any question for the participants?
I have a question, Yusri.
Okay, sir. Okay, Sir Amirullah, he is one of professor in my university also.
Hello, change. Mr. Amirullah.
Hello, I would like to change the background first. So, yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So the ground is not really it's fake. Fake. Nice to see you, Miss Cristina. Yes, and I think it was a really wonderful presentation, and I love some of the ideas of how to build interactive, communicative and enjoyable learning for the student. I'd like to ask you, what's the best thing that you did, especially during this pandemic, for the online discussion, to build a balance four skill of English? You can tell me from your experience or from others. That's all, Ms. Cristina.
Okay, you know, before we have started, I don't think anybody was ever prepared for the pandemic. When it hit us, there was a sudden shift, or there was a sudden call for an online instruction, and we had to come up with a month of break in order for all of the teachers to be trained. So we were provided with the platform, and that platform has to be studied intensively. So our attention is actually divided into learning the platform in order to exhaust all of the features well and being able to conduct the syllabus that we need to finish for the term. So when we have finally started the term, we were very lucky that the platform chosen by our university allowed for a more interactive way of learning the language. Like, there is a chat feature, and then Zoom is already included in that platform. The platform, by the way, is Canvas. And Canvas also allows for peer evaluation. We make use of breakout rooms. In fact, just last night when I was teaching my graduate school students, and I had to use the breakout room for the first time because it was a writing class. And so there were so many individualized activities that I have to conduct. One of the students sent me an email just this morning and told me that they have tremendously enjoyed the breakout rooms because they had time to really talk with the other students. And being able to talk with the other students, again, goes back to what I said a while ago about negotiating with meaning. So during breakout rooms, so this is something that is very good about the platform that we have chosen. During breakout rooms, the teachers can join the group rooms, okay? So every time I join a room and I hear them not entirely speaking in English, and then just like what I have said, that they have to be reminded that they have to negotiate for the meaning in English. So I believe that even if I am handling writing classes right now, it would still be very much possible for collaboration to take place. I understand how breakout rooms work out for my classes right now, but just two terms ago, I'm still grappling my way around Canvas, and breakout rooms never happened during synchronous sessions. So I would only ask them to please get each other's Zoom accounts so that they can meet outside of the synchronous sessions. And I don't think that is going to be very helpful because they also have their other classes. They also have their work to think about. So the fact that this is an opportunity that I presented them inside of the classroom means that I believe that I am able to target also the four macro skills. It's going to be a shame if I tell you that you are not supposed to teach a macro skill in isolation, and I don't practice that. So even if it is mostly writing, I still make sure that there will still be listening and there will still be speaking. And of course, mostly reading into writing in my classes.
Antin, thank you. Yeah, I return to you. Payusri.
Thank you, Amir. Okay. Yeah. Amirullah.
You can call me Amir.
Okay. General Prof. Amirullah. Prof. Amirullah is the committee chair of the TESOL conference which is organized in the previous years. I think Cristina is one of the presenters also.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. And I think that's how Yusri was able to contact me because he was able to listen to my lecture in University of Makassar, Indonesia.
Yeah, yeah. I was really busy.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, sir. Okay, is there any question by Haki? Bayhaki, I think Bayhaki wants to ask question. Bayhaki? Okay, Bayhaki, no, Andro.
Alessandro, sir, okay.
Okay, Alessandro.
Yes, sir. Okay. Ma'am Cristina or Miss Cristina? Well, the problem of me when it comes to the lack of vocabulary. So do you have tips to manage the lack of vocabulary, since when it comes to say something, I'm afraid that, you know, I don't know the correct word to convey the message of my speech. And I'm afraid that it will make the other person who is speaking with me is misunderstood with the message of what I'm saying. So do you have, you know, tips or how do you manage with that problem? Thank you.
Okay, Alessandro, I do not have an advice in learning vocabulary. And that was a part of what I have mentioned about how vocabulary should never be taught in isolation, because if you are going to be consumed whether you are using the right words, then you will really never be able to communicate. That's why I said that you should be able to give yourself an opportunity to talk to people who speak in English, because you will negotiate with meaning. So you do not know the word, okay, which would substantiate what you are trying to say. You try to look for other words, and then you try to search for other words if ever the words that you have used are not understood, until finally you get to reach to a level of understanding so that the other person will understand you. But learning vocabulary alone, that will not help you at all in learning English. You would like to widen your vocabulary, you have to read more. If you read more, then you will be better in reading. But unless you try to use that and give that a more active role, then you will really always find it difficult to communicate. When I said a while ago that you do not be consumed as well with how you sound, meaning you do not think about whether your accent is right or wrong or whether the other person finds your accent to be funny, that is also including vocabulary. It doesn't matter when your words are not as accurate or not as sophisticated, or if you are committing a lot of lapses in grammar, the fact that you are able to communicate, remember what I said at the start, then the communication process has been successful.
Okay. Is it clear, Andro? Okay.
Yes, sir, it is.
Okay. Okay. Is there any question? Other participants? Okay. Before the participant, basically, I have a question for Miss Cristina.
Okay.
I really agree before that you said that Philippines is good option to study English before when we go to like Australia or US, it's really expensive, especially for Indonesia, because Indonesia and Philippines are really near than like going to the US and the others.
It's an expensive way to study English. It's an inexpensive country to expose yourself in English.
Okay. So my question, is there any like opportunities, like how to say, internship program? Because in a university, in my university, when a student wants to graduate their study, there is like, they should attend or follow like internship program. So is there any opportunity or chance to doing internship program to Philippines or others?
Yes, there are so many opportunities for internship programs. In fact, we have a lot of partnerships with Thailand, with Japan, and with China. Sadly, our students are not sent to Indonesia for internship, in the same way that I have seldom experienced having Indonesian interns in our college. So probably this is something that we can work around with, and also something probably that you can propose to your university so that you would have more opportunities for your students for internship. And I understand how most students from the countries I have mentioned would like to visit the Philippines, especially if they are in the field of language learning, because like what you have mentioned, it is a very inexpensive way to expose yourself in the English language. So we have a lot of partnerships, but I am yet to hear about a partnership with any Indonesian school. And so probably that is something which should be proposed, and something that you can try to arrange so that you would have more opportunity for your students to be exposed outside.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Okay, is there any question for the participants? Okay, here's Faisal.
What is the first thing we should learn about English? I mean, some of my friends want to learn English, but they don't know which part do he should learn first. Is it reading first, listening first, or speaking first?
Okay.
Okay, Faisal, it would depend on your objective. What is your objective? Is it going to be intrinsic? Is it going to be extrinsic? Would you like to learn English in order to secure a job? Would you like to learn English because you are in a relationship with someone who speaks English? That's intrinsic, by the way. Would you like to learn English in order for you to get into the university? So it would depend on your personal objective in learning English. If your objective, if I may just refer to your previous answer at the start of the presentation, be able to speak in English because you just would like to be more fluent in speaking in English, then the best way for you to learn English is for you to speak in English. And there's nothing else that I could say about that. And there are already a lot of studies which would claim that that really is the only way for you to be able to speak in English. You may not have a wide vocabulary. You may not be able to understand highfalutin scholarly articles, but it's possible for you to be good in communicating orally. It is possible. And that can only be possible if you use it a lot.
Okay, Faisal, is it clear?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So yeah, it depends on your needs. Okay, is there any question?
Yeah, I would like to ask some questions.
Okay, the last question from Alif. Okay, Alif, please.
Miss Cristina, well, I really want to know about this from your country. Is it really true that your people that it's speaking English is the like it's their daily basis in their life, so which means English is not just a second language, but it's very common to them? Because I also have a friend in Finland scene also, so and they speak it very well as me, so like I'm very surprised. So is it true, is English is there like very common speaking in Philippines?
I would have to say yes. Okay, Alif. So you have a friend in the Philippines. I would have to say that yes, English is spoken 80% of the time. Even if you are not inside of an English class, even outside, even when you just come across a stranger, you can talk to that person in English and that person will be able to answer you back in English. It was historically, okay, because we were first educated by American soldiers, and you know, of course, we have won that lottery in learning that language, because that means that the first few people who then taught the next generation used just English, and it just became a part of the Philippine culture to be good in English. And then that's also the reason why immediately upon arrival in the Philippines, you would all just see English signboards, even in the airport, and all of the traffic signboards, everything that you see are all in English. It's going to be very seldom for you to see a signboard that is in Tagalog. So I understand that that also helped the Filipinos be more exposed to the language. And so many of the things of are very common to them. It's pretty much basic communication is something that they can already carry. So I do not want to say that we are native speakers of English, because English is still considered to be a second language. However, I know for a fact that it is a preferred language in most contexts than the native language.
Okay, thank you. So maybe Philippines has a history, so it's really close with the English, because in Indonesia, English is not a second language, it's a foreign language.
It's a foreign language, yes.
Yeah, foreign language. It's different with the Philippine being English as a second language. So common people can communicate using English. Okay, Alif, is it clear? Okay.
Very clear, sir.
Okay, thank you. I think it's the last question from Alif. So it's the last session from our this general lecture. And then maybe Ma'am Cristina or Miss Cristina want to like a closing statement and giving my student like motivation to study English. But before you mentioned before the one of the challenges in studying mm-hmm. English, like motivation. Student mm-hmm. don't know what the purpose to studying English. Mm-hmm. Okay.
My closing remarks are pretty much similar to the closing remarks I gave you. Please do not think that the only way for you to learn English is inside of the classroom. I have never learned English that way. English that you bring inside of the classroom will just be polished inside of the classroom and will not teach you more than what you already know. So the only way for you to learn English is to assume a more active role in learning it. So that those are my closing remarks.
Okay, thank you. And then to Memphebi, as a head of the Department of English Literature, to give also like a closing statement.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Yusri. I agree, totally agree with Ms. Cristina. For students, even for us, the lecturers, we still need to learn more. For students, just build your confidence in order to talk and to speak English. What you need most is patience to learn. So you could learn and motivate to learn English, and you can use it for your future also. Objective is important, just as Ms. Cristina said. However, just be confident, please. Try to be more passionate students. I hope that this general lecture will help you, or will give you will give you new horizons in what English is and how to learn English for a better future. I think that's all, seriously, for Ms. Cristina. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you too.
Thank you, Ma'am Febi, as a head of the Department of English Literature. And from the deepest of my heart, I say that thank you so much for your participating in this general lecture, from Ms. Cristina, from Jai Mark, the Prof. Amirullah, and Ma'am Febi, and for Australia attending this workshop also. Thank you, and then good day, everyone, and then see you in the next general lecture.
Could we talk a picture, Mr. Yusri? Please
talk. Okay, we will take a picture.
Yes.
Okay.
Please open up your camera video.
Yeah. Okay. All the participants, you can open your turn on your camera, please.
All right.
Wait a moment.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, cheese. All right. Next. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Got it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
See you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Cristina. We'll happy to see you next time.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye. Keep healthy, everybody.
All the life she has seen, all the meanest side of me. They took away the prophet's dream for a prophet on the street. Now she's stronger than you know. A heart of steel starts to grow. All his life he's been told he'll be nothing when he's old. All the kicks and all the blows.
Okay, for this student, I think it's enough for this lecture. You can log on for your phone and then waiting my instructions about the assignment.
All right, thank you,
Mr. Kelly.
Bye.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, salam sehat semua.